Hello, everyone. Welcome to worship with Bethel International United Methodist Church for Sunday, September the 6th. I'm Carrie, and we want to welcome you to a very special online worship with Bethel International Church today. We're going to celebrate a children's Sabbath. We're focusing on the needs of children and families in our neighborhood and specific ways to help. You may want to get something to take notes. I know you'll want to help ensure that every child has a healthy, fair, safe, and moral start in life. Welcome to Bethel International Church and a Children's Sabbath. So let's get started by remembering why we're here. Please say with me our mission and our vision. Our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And our vision is to be an amazingly international church where faith is contagious and invitational. Got an update on Carla's mask ministry. She sold 49 more face masks, bringing her total contribution to $1,134 to the church. Thank you, Carla. Cool. Orders are ongoing. Masks are $15, 10 of which goes to the church and 5 to replenish supplies. Carla now has a design with a removable nose strip for laundering, better for, you know, glasses wearers. To place an order, just call the church office. And thank you to everybody who registered for our Habitat for Humanity work days. There are still some slots open on Saturday, October 3rd and November 7th. Call the church office to sign up. We've already raised $900 toward our $2,500 goal for this year's house. Very cool. If you've been meaning to go to our website's online contribution button, or if you've written your check but haven't sent it in yet, pause the video. Go take care of that and come on back. We do not want Jane showing up in my backyard with her hard hat and hammer. Next Sunday, we're going to start a new worship series called A Church for Everyone. Worship in heaven is international worship. The early church became multicultural on purpose. And Pastor Glenn will interview friends about how churches become more diverse. It starts next week. A Church for Everyone. Sounds awesome. And now, children of God, let's clap our hands and move our feet because our Redeemer lives.
Change taking. Our first Children's Sabbath presentation is about education and family life during COVID-19. I'll share with you the story of one of our preschool families. We'll hear from Gage Volbert, who is the counselor at nearby Gables Elementary School. We'll hear from Bethel International member Jen Isles, a mom and special needs teacher with health risks. And our preschool director, Michelle Meifert, will share a few words. And finally, Miss Sarah will tell how we can come alongside some children, be supportive and helpful during this challenging year. Here's what one of our preschool moms wrote. She says, in spring of 2019, I got us away, escaping a horribly abusive marriage of almost 10 years. I got myself and my four young kids to safety. We were shaken and I was in a daze. Back in Columbus, I needed a community, a place to feel safe and understood. I also needed a preschool for my third child. That's how I came to Bethel International Church, which has been a huge support for my family, welcoming my child into preschool, being patient with me on my journey, and making my entire family feel safe and accepted. COVID-19, of course, has disrupted everyone's life, but I was faced with an impossible choice. Homeschool and distance learning with four children in different age groups felt like my only option. But that meant I would once again have to push aside my own degree, my own looking for work, my own goals, just like in my abusive marriage. And lockdown put my children back in an eerily familiar situation of isolation and fear. When Michelle reached out, offering my older kids a place in the school-age classrooms, I felt this huge weight lifted. It was like a wild blessing. I no longer felt overburdened. I no longer needed to put off my own dreams of finishing a degree. Now my kids are excited about learning again, about making friends, and seeing their mom follow her dreams and reach her goals. It's the kind of community I was looking for. I know that feeling fear and anxiety in this month is a common tie that binds us all. But thank you, Pastor Glenn. You have prayed for my family and let me know that your church is there for us. And a very heartfelt thank you to Michelle, who has been on my team from the start. I will never forget our tearful first encounter and the compassion I felt from your heart for my children.
Hello, my name is Gage Volbert, and I'm the school counselor for Gables Elementary School. Pastor Glenn and I have been communicating through email this summer about ways to further the partnership between Bethel International and Gables Elementary. For those of you who may be unfamiliar with our school, we're a kindergarten through fifth grade building located at 1680 Beckett Avenue, and we have over 400 students in our population that represent over 30 different countries. As I'm sure you're aware, it's not been easy since March for many people across this country, and that's for sure been true for many of our families. They're facing a lot of the same issues that you hear about with families losing jobs, struggling to afford and maintain housing. But a lot of them also have concerns with, you know, families being overseas or them navigating unemployment with an additional language barrier in place. And all of that is now coming together as we transition back into another school year. But I'm confident that as Gable Gators that we're going to persevere through these difficult times in large part because of our community partnerships, especially the ones that we have with organizations like Bethel International Church. While our students don't start back until Tuesday, September 8th, we already have reached out to our families to discuss the needs for childcare, food, shelter, and beyond so that when we know what our needs are, that we're able to share them with you. I want to take a moment to thank you so much for your assistance during these scary and overwhelming times. We appreciate your willingness to think of our families and to show compassion for your neighbors. Because, as we've learned over these past few months, we're only as strong and resilient as the communities in which we live. I would like to thank you so much, and I look forward to working with you this school year, and please stay healthy and take care. Thanks.
Hi, this is Jen. I am a teacher. I teach high needs special education students. Pastor Glenn asked me to talk a little bit about our situation and just in education in general. So what I want to talk about is that there's not one set right way to be doing education right now. We all have struggles that we face, whether that's a single mom, whether that's, in our case, I have an autoimmune disease and I take immunosuppressants. So being in the classroom right now, as much as I would way rather be there and be with kids, is not an option. So my choice is to be there for kids who also can't be in the classroom. But every family faces some challenges, and we all need to be kind and understanding. We need to be there for each other and be supportive. Whether your student is brick and mortar, whether your student is blended, whether your student's BLA, whether you don't even have kids, but you know families that are making some really hard decisions right now, it's important that in general we be kind to one another. There's not one right way to do things. None of us have ever lived in this time, in this type of situation, in a pandemic. It's just not something any of us were prepared for. I was at school on a Thursday, and we were knowing some things were going to happen, but we didn't know what. On Friday, they said, we're sending the kids home, and they're not coming back. We thought for a couple of weeks, but here we are. It's the beginning of a whole new school year, and we're still at home. And so families are doing things that they've never had to do, making choices. My son had to choose. He chose to stay at home and do school online this year. Hurtfully guilty. I feel guilty. But he said he didn't want to get me sick. And that was his choice. I never asked him to stay at home. And he does it because he feels it's the right thing to do. And we all just need to be kind with one another. So everybody's going through something that no one else knows about. And so we need to work together to support each other. Whether you have kids that need support, whether you have families that you can support, even if you don't have kids yourself, we're all doing something we've never done before. So the big thing for me is just be kind to each other and support each other. And I hope that that this pandemic changes that not everybody has to do the same thing, and that it's okay to do things a little bit differently than someone else. So here is me hoping that the world can learn a little more kindness in the face of struggle.
Our Sunday morning curriculum offers a parent support called Parent Q. They give these three tips for surviving the back to school season. First, plan to plan. Initiate a Sunday night huddle, which could include older children, where you look at the week ahead, you plan meals, make general decisions, and discuss any potential conflicts. Secondly, schedule some fun, a treat to look forward to, something on the calendar to count down to. Lastly, let yourselves off the hook. Prioritize, simplify, and don't apologize for guarding the gate of your family's calendar. You be you, parents. How can I get involved? I'm glad you asked. We are initiating a program called the Guardian Angel Project. For $10, you may support one of our kids, which includes our preschoolers, our school age program, our Bethel kids, and our youth. The money will be used to provide a book or a small token of encouragement for the children throughout the school year. You'll be sent the child's name and age so that you may pray for the children. And also, if you'd like to drop them a note throughout the school year, you can put that in the church office and we'll make sure it gets delivered. At the end of the school year, we are hoping to hold a gathering where you may meet your child face to face. In order to sign up, you may go to mybethel.org/GA, and that will lead you directly to the sign up page and payment page. And of course, if you have any questions, you may email me directly at mychildren@bethel.org. Thank you so much for your support.
Hi, I'm Griffin Crow, and I'll lead you in a prayer today. Please join me in our prayer for this worship series. Fill me, O Lord, with a childlike spirit. Make my church a family, and my family a church. Put me to work where children need me the most. Let us pray. O God, maker of us all, help us see your love today in children's faces. May we sense your concern for the struggles of children and families, and hear your call to serve the hungry and the oppressed. Make us angry at suffering and injustice. Make us bold in our commitment to serve, and fill us with hope by your power and your love. We pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. From thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It is that time in our service when Miss Sarah shares her wisdom with us, and probably some really cute videos. So, pause it if you need to, gather the people that need to see this section, and let's listen in on what she has to say.
Hey there, it's great to see you. I thought since a lot of you have started school, it'd be super fun to have a math quiz today. All right, I'm going to give you some math problems and just shout out the answer when you know it. Here we go. 1 plus 1, 2. 2 plus 2, 4. 2 times 2, yep, still 4. How about 3 times 4? Nice, it's 12. All right, 27 times 9. I don't even know the answer to that one. I'm going to need a little help from my calculator. 27 times 9 equals, 243. Did you get that? Great job. Sometimes we need a little help, and that's okay. Every day we face problems in our life. Some of them are easy, like what should I wear? Or what should I have for breakfast? Fruit Loops or Apple Jacks? But sooner or later, we will have a problem that we just don't know how to solve on our own. Isn't it good to know that God is always there to help us? The Bible says that God is our help in time of trouble. All we have to do is ask. All right, today I have a video from the Seaball family. Annalise, Esmarie, and Spencer are going to show us the joys and sometimes frustrations of riding a bike. And then I have some pictures of a friend who watches us from Tennessee. That's right, Rhett, who is 2.5, watches with our very own Mary Schnegg. So sit back and enjoy and have a great week. I'll see you soon.
Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give away, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam. And the mountains quake with their surging, there the river, those streams make glad the city of God. The holy place where the Most High dwells, God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdom falls. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done. The desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shield with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Our next segment is how to talk to your child about race and racism. In June and July, a few of us from Bethel attended a series of anti-racism classes via Zoom, led by the Reverend Jackie Lewis from Middle Church in Manhattan. One of her speakers, a pastor at her church, Amanda Hambrick Ashcraft, had some good things to say about raising anti-racist children.
Because every single one of us, whether or not we have biological children, are parents. At the playground, in our houses of worship, at the schoolyard, no matter where, we are all doing this work. But what? How do you do it? Like, what does it mean to raise an anti-racist generation or an anti-racist family? And, you know, we say, well, one, we just need to talk about it. You know, we need to acknowledge that race is a thing and that color is a thing, and we're not all colorblind. We see color. And so one of the easiest ways to do that with kids is through books. And there is a plethora of books out there available.
The nicest white people I know think the way to raise their children is to, quote, not talk about race, to not bring up race, to, quote, help them to think of everybody as equal and the same. But the children are registering color, they're registering hue. What's your thought about how to normalize that race as just a part of identity and to help young people talk about it?
That's a great question, Jackie. Again, that can happen in books and in imaginative play. You know, we are very intentional about not just buying all white dolls, not just buying all toys that look like us. And we will not just not do that, not only not do that, but we'll talk about it too. And we'll say, what can you tell us about how this doll looks? What can you tell us about how this doll looks? And what's different there? Mm-hmm. And what's the same? And what looks like you? And what doesn't look like you? Another really easy way to do that is when you are just walking around with your kids. So you just, let's just say you've left somewhere, where we've left a park. We'll often say, what did you notice about the kids who were playing at that park? Mm-hmm. They'll say maybe something, but they're pretty good now. They'll say, oh, they were mostly white. Or they'll say, those were mostly brown kids. So just to even be able to get young kids to talk about what, how they're experiencing the world with what they see as far as race is very important.
As Amanda mentioned, books are a great place to start. I have been purchasing books for our children and preschoolers so that when we can come back into the building, we'll have some to share. Until then, I've been posting some read-alouds on our BIUMC Children's Ministry Facebook page. And once again, referencing our parent cue, they say this: kids model what they see. Before talking with your children, ask yourself these questions. One, how are you processing your feelings? Identify how you might need to change in your prejudices and interactions with others. Next, do you celebrate diversity? Do you model the belief with your actions and words that God made each of us unique and beautiful, even in our differences? Do you demonstrate respect and honor toward those you disagree with? How diverse is your circle of friends and the people you associate with? Children need to see people coming to their home who look different than them. Children should be exposed to cultures different than their own. Children should see their parents laugh and talk with other races. It's essential for children to see people who look like them do amazing things, and also essential for them to see people who don't look like them do amazing things. This will help them grow up not only knowing things should be equal, but become initiators of racial equality. Next, are you talking about racism? Racism is a difficult and sensitive topic, but it does exist. Talk about the issues with others outside your circle and with people of different backgrounds. Discover the truth from various outlets and seek to understand other perspectives. And when you find the right words that honestly express how you think and feel, talk with your kids. And lastly, are you focused on love? Focus on what matters, love. Talk about how your family can respond to what's happening in a positive way. Put love into action and rest in the hope that is found there. Early in the spring, Sesame Street, which is near and dear to my heart, hosted a town hall on racism. So I'm going to close this segment with how they ended their discussion.
I want you a picture of what Elmo wants. All of us loving each other. Oh, yeah. Elmo is going to bring the sign to the community center to show Elmo support because Elmo can do better.
I 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 can do better.
We can do better.
We must do better. We will do better.
Let's come together.
All of us, no matter the color of our skin.
And stand together.
To make this a kind and safe place to live for everyone.
Our final topic today is the impact of hunger on children. Food insecurity is all around us and in every neighborhood. The food insecurity rate for children in Franklin County is 19%, which translates to 57,520 children. I took a look at our neighboring schools. At Gables Elementary, 39% qualify for free lunch and 4% for reduced lunch, which equals 178 of their 417 students. At Centennial High School, of their 776 students, 56% qualify for free lunch and 5% for reduced lunch, which equals 472 students. Food insecurity refers to the lack of access at times to enough food for an actively healthy lifestyle for all household members and limited access to nutritionally adequate food. Food insecure households are not necessarily food insecure all the time. Food insecurity may reflect a household's need to make trade-offs between basic needs such as housing or medical bills and purchasing nutritionally adequate foods. Food insecurity impacts cognitive development among young children, including increased illnesses and higher healthcare costs. This is why many schools hesitate to cancel during inclement weather for fear that those children will not have any food during the times that they're off. In March, when the school buildings themselves shut down due to the coronavirus, the school districts found ways to provide food, breakfast and lunch, to all the children in their districts. And most of the districts provided that food throughout the end of the school year in May. Some districts got really creative. For example, one school district's bus drivers took the meals and provided food to every child on their route, which I thought was really fun. 2 years ago, a young couple here in Columbus was searching for a charitable organization that would allow their children to participate. And after being turned away time after time, they decided to start their own charity. They wanted their children to know that every good deed counts and that we can all help in some way, big or small. I love that. They started Columbus Blessing Box Project in January of 2018 by purchasing some used cabinets on Craigslist, and they turned them into blessing boxes. They celebrated their 2-year birthday not long ago, and I am excited to announce blessing box number 63, which is our own Bethel Blessing Box, located in the southeast corner of our parking lot. I reached out to Jenny Whetstone thinking that she would know how to get this accomplished, and she did. She reached out to her small group, and they totally embraced this project. It's magnificent. I am so excited and thrilled by what they did. Thank you so much. How can I help? I'm glad you asked. If you would like to donate food, we have a list of the most needed food items, which is available on our website and our Facebook page. You can bring food and put it directly in the Bethel Blessing Box. If it's full, feel free to drop it at the church office between 9 and noon, Monday through Friday. And if there's a surplus of food, we will make sure that it is shared with whomever needs it. Thanks again for your continued support.
The words to our anthem, A Heart Song Blessing, were written by Maddie Stepanek. Maddie was an American poet who published 7 best-selling books of poetry and peace essays. He was a peace advocate and motivational speaker who appeared on many television shows such as The Oprah Winfrey Show. Maddie died at the age of 13 of a rare neurological disorder, but he left us many wonderful poems. This one was set to music by Joseph Martin.
Let our breath be gentle wind. Let our ears be of the
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Amen.